Good morning to those online. Good morning to those that are walking in. I think we're moving a little slow this morning. I know when I got some gas this morning, I was thinking that it's just a little bit chilly. Just a little bit. And it was to the point where I actually had to put some gloves on this morning. It was that cold. And I got in my car and I turned on my car and it said -4 degrees Fahrenheit. -4 degrees Fahrenheit. Woo! That's really cold. Now, those of you that don't like Fahrenheit, think of Celsius. Do some math in your head, you convert Fahrenheit to Celsius, and -20 degrees Celsius. That sounds more impressive, doesn't it?
Wow.
Yeah, I know. It's like, wow, it's really cold out there. However, we're still here. We're going to have church. We're going to love the Lord together. We're going to sing some songs. We're going to have a little preaching. Hopefully it's good preaching. We'll see. We'll figure that out by the time we get there. Father, we thank you so much that you're here with us, Lord. And Lord, I just ask that as we gather together, whether we're online or whether we're in the building itself, Lord, that you'll be with us. Lord, that we will take the time to meet with you today, that we'll take the time to glorify you. Holy Spirit, I ask that you move amongst us this morning, that you open our hearts, you open our minds to know more of you, that you help us to love you more, you help us to love each other more, you help us to be the church that you created us to be. Just be with us, Lord. Help us to glorify you this morning. In your name we pray, amen.
Okay, well, Nick and Erica were not able to join us this morning, so ta-da.
you get the two of us.
Woo-hoo!
Water to my soul. I
tasted in a galaxy. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you. There is one day in your coat. There is one day in your house. There is one day in your clothes that thousands elsewhere. There is one day in your coat. There is one day in your house. There is one day in your clothes that thousands elsewhere. There is one day in your coat. There is one day in your house. There is one day in your clothes that thousands elsewhere. Thousands elsewhere. I'm in all of you. where your love ran red and my sins washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. Jesus.
You could have just done like a prayer or something. Explain all that.
I want to talk about why you're pausing. We're pausing to worship the Lord.
Amen.
Lord, I come. Guides my heart.
Well, Ed's in Florida, so let's pray for Ed. Let's pray that he's having a wonderful time in Florida, and that he wants and longs to come back to this. It doesn't get any better than this.
You know, you
stink. Lord, we thank you, Father, and Lord, as we prepare to give back to you, Holy Spirit, that you would make us cheerful givers. Holy Spirit, that you would just help us to realize that everything we have belongs to you. Lord, as we just give a little bit back, help us remember that and to thank you for for everything. I thank you for the very air that we breathe. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
So last week, I preached about conflict in the church, right? And the title of that sermon was, Let's Fight. Because, well, you laugh, but the thing is, conflict will exist. No matter what, no matter what, doesn't matter how perfect the church is, or how perfect any community is, conflict of some type, some way will exist. It's going to happen. You can be constructive with the conflict, and everybody can grow through it, or you can be destructive to the conflict. It's really our choice. It's how we choose to handle it. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
I would think so. I hope you agree with that, because that's what my premise is.
Yes, sir.
And we need to deal with conflict. We have to. We can't just let it sit there and stew. Right, it festers. And it's interesting you say that, because when I think about festering, I think about when I get a splinter. Who's ever had a splinter? And I think just about everybody's had a splinter. And I know when I get a splinter, I like to, you know, it hurts. I like to leave it in there. When I leave it in there, it starts to hurt some more. And eventually, it just starts to get nasty and red and pussy and gross, doesn't it? And you think it's just a little splinter. I could have just taken it out and been done with it. No, let's leave it in there. Because I want the pain. I love the pain. Nobody loves that pain. Right? We get a splinter, what do? We get it out of there. Because otherwise, that infection, if you leave it in there, it ends up, you know, throw out my whole finger, throw out my whole hand, and maybe I get gangrene, have to cut my whole arm off. All because of a little splinter that we didn't take care of in the first place. Sometimes we have to cut them out. So it takes a little more pain to finally get them out. But we have to clear away. Same thing with the conflict. We have to redeem the conflict. Because we are a church and a body of redemption. Of being in perfect relationship with one another. We let conflict stew. It gets infected. And conflict, if you let it continue, no matter how small it is, can, will, and does destroy a church. Think about it. Think about church splits. How many churches have you known that have split? Some because of just tiny conflict that should have been dealt with immediately. So as such, we're going to talk about Matthew 18. So if you open your Bible to Matthew 18, and Jesus here lays out how we as the church should deal with conflict. He gives us four steps. Four steps on how to deal with it. And today, as I'm going through Matthew 18, I'm preaching, I'm going to give you some ideas that are not my ideas. I read this book called Making Peace by Jim Van Yerpen. I just want you to know that if you have read this book like I have, you might understand, you might recognize some of the concepts I'm going to talk about. They're not my concepts. I stole them from somebody. Borrowed them. And I'm giving him credit, so I'm not actually stealing it. That's how we're supposed to do. So in Matthew 18, Jesus himself lays out these four steps. We go down to verse 15. If any believer sins against you, go privately and point out the offense. If the other person listens and confesses, you have won that person back. But if you're unsuccessful, take one or two others with you and go back again, so that everything you say may be confirmed by two or three witnesses. If the person still refuses to listen, take your case to the church. Then if he or she won't accept the church's decision, treat that person as a pagan or a corrupt tax collector. Four steps. Did we catch all four steps?
Yeah.
Go to that person individually, then bring one or two people with you, then you bring it before the church. And then if that doesn't work out, then we may have to part ways. Now, this particular way to handle conflict is to handle conflict within the church, specifically within the church. That's what Jesus is talking about here. And before we get into step one and really start to talk about step one and what we should be doing, there are two kind of ways of thinking, two mindsets. There's a right side and there's a left side. I want you to think about the right side and the left side and where do you fit in. The right side is, in every conflict, somebody's right and wrong. There's a letter of the law. That's the right side. Somebody has to be right and somebody has to be wrong. Some people think that way. That's their view. That's how they think. And that's okay. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just recognizing where we're at, where we think. Then there's the left side, where it doesn't matter so much about who's right and who's wrong, but all that matters is that we restore the relationship. It's all about the relationship. It's not about the actual conflict itself. We just have to restore the relationship. Well, if you are all the way on the right side, you need to come a little bit to the left. If you're all the way to the left, you need to come a little bit to the right. Because both sides, there are problems with both sides. In a conflict, if it's all about being right and who's wrong, you're not worried about restoring a relationship. You're just worried about who's right. If you're always worried about just restoring a relationship, let's just forget, forgive and forget. Well, that doesn't always happen either. So it takes the whole church body sometimes and to kind of view our thinking and to help each other along to help us see things differently. Now, there are four different ways how we respond to conflict that are not good. First way is passive response. Are you a passive responder to conflict? If somebody were to sin against you, now understand that sin against you may not be an actual sin. If they hurt you in any way, shape, or form, it's your perspective that they sinned against you. So a passive responder, they're not going to bring it up because they don't want to fight. They don't want to go into the conflict. They'll do everything they can to not talk about it. They'll take it home with them. They'll stew on it for a while. They'll let that splinter sit there for weeks, months, years even, because they're afraid of the conflict. And we need to have the conflict. It's good that we have the conflict if we do it constructively. Then there's the evasive people. They will do everything they can to skirt around the issue. And if you know me, maybe I'm a little bit evasive. You ask me what's wrong, I'm going to tell you nothing. Right? To do everything I can to not pick out the problem, to not talk about the issue. Let's go some other direction. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to deal with it. It's painful when we deal with conflict, isn't it? Yeah, that's okay. It should be painful. Then there's the person who's defensive. Catherine, you're wrong. You're like, nope, I'm not wrong.
Nope.
You're going to do everything you can to prove your point. You're going to do everything you can to prove your point, to prove that the conflict is not about me. I didn't do anything wrong. Sometimes, even what's really bad is in the church, a defensive person may, well, God told me. Oh, yeah. Right? How many have heard that before? Uh-huh. Yep. Or it's that right-minded person that stands on their doctrine. Now, again, it's about being right and being wrong. The defensive person, they're going to be right no matter what. They will not in any way, shape, or form say that they're wrong. That's just who they are. Again, these are not good ways to deal with conflict. Let's recognize where we're at. The fourth one is the aggressive person. You go to them with a conflict and they want to fight. They want to fight. They want to take you to court. They want to beat you down again. They're instead of being defensive and proving their point, they're going to come at you and attack you and show you how you're wrong and how they're right. None of these are good mindsets. Recognize where you're at, recognize your weakness, and hopefully look around and see somebody else that that has a different mindset than you. And you might know people who, okay, I'm evasive. Catherine is passive. So Catherine might learn something from somebody who's a little more aggressive. Right? And it's okay. This is my weakness. I need to go to someone who understands my weakness, who helps me through it. As the body of Christ, that's what we're supposed to be doing. Helping each other out. Now, let's talk about step one. My brother sins against me. Whether it's an actual sin, or they just...
Perception.
They said something that bothered me, whether it's right, wrong, or different, or they said something that's dead on, but still hurts me. How long should you wait before you go to that person? Not long at all. Let's look at Matthew 5 and see what Jesus says about this. Matthew 5. I go down to verse 23. So you're presenting a sacrifice at the altar in the temple, and suddenly you remember that someone has something against you. Okay, so here you are in church to worship God, and you remember that somebody has something against you. He says, leave your sacrifice there at the altar. Go and be reconciled to that person. Then come and offer your sacrifice to God. Maybe I'm missing something, but is Jesus saying it's more important for us to reconcile with our brothers and our sisters than it is to come and worship Him in the church? Yeah. Reconciliation is huge. Reconciliation is important. Why? Because unresolved conflict will destroy a church. Unresolved conflict has destroyed multiple churches. And we need to be redeeming people, about redemption, about dealing with the conflict. Which means immediately, if not sooner, I go to that person. Paul says it in Ephesians 4, 26 through 27. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. Same basic thing. Somebody hurts you, somebody sins against you, you're mad, you're upset. Don't let the sun go down. Go immediately, if not sooner. Go to them, deal with it, and get it out of your system. Now, step one. I go to that person, and that person blows me off. Can I control how they react? No. What does Jesus tell us to do? First he just tells us to go, right? I can't control how they act. So I'm going to go and tell this person about the conflict, and it's not go tell somebody else. Go get somebody else. Okay, yeah, go get somebody else. So they didn't respond like I wanted to, or first off, let's say I don't even go to the person in the first place, and I want to talk to somebody else. What he calls it is the sin of triangulation. Everyone knows what a triangle looks like, right? 3 points. So the sin of triangulation is, Jim, I've wronged you, and you go tell Sandy about it. Is that ever right? Is that ever correct? Never. It is never, ever correct. Maybe outside the church you can think, but I'm talking inside the church. Inside this church body, if somebody wrongs you, I don't care how small or insignificant you think it happens to be, you don't tell somebody else about it. You go directly to that person. Directly to them. You may not get the satisfaction you want, but Jesus doesn't care about you getting the satisfaction you want the first time around. He tells you to go. That is our obedience, to go to them. That is step one. Now, there are times where, well, maybe I can justify going. Maybe I can justify the conflict. Maybe I can be legalistic about it. Well, it wasn't really a sin. They didn't really sin. They told me my hair was too long. That's not a sin, right? Maybe it bugged me. Maybe it hurt me. It was conflict with me. But it wasn't really a sin. So I'm just going to go tell my wife about Debbie talking about my hair. I shouldn't do that. Especially if it hurt me. It doesn't matter what my perspective. My perspective is I was hurt. So I should go to Debbie. Well, maybe I was at fault. Maybe it was just me. So I'm going to go talk to somebody else and see. Maybe, you know, Joe said that my shoes were the wrong color. And I got mad. So I'm going to go talk to Catherine about it. If you got mad, if you got upset, whether it's perspective or not, go talk to Joe. Don't talk to Catherine to try and get satisfaction why you should go talk to Joe. Just go talk to Joe. Don't try and talk your way out of this conflict. And don't talk to anybody else about it. Go to the person and talk to them. Now the person, you talk to them. Now then you bring somebody else in. Only then. Then you go to step two. However, I don't think we're quite to step two yet. Let's still talk about this triangulation issue. Let's say I go to Ed. And I start to talk to Ed about what Jim has done to me. Ed, do you have a responsibility to say something?
No.
Yes, actually, you do. I'm going to you and tell you my problem with Jim. You need to call me out on this triangulation. To say, whoa, stop, Dan. I don't want to know it. I don't want to know what the issue is. Have you talked to Jim? We send the person to, have you talked to that person you have a problem with? Guess what? They've actually brought us into their problem now. So we don't just say, go talk to Jim and ignore it. We say, don't talk to me about it. I want you to go talk to Jim about it. Talk directly to him. Oh, and by the way, tomorrow I'm going to call you up to see if you actually talked to Jim. Accountability at this point, right? So as a church, that's part of being accountable to one another, being submissive to one another. You brought me into your conflict when you shouldn't have. Now you get to deal with me as part of your conflict. So I'm going to make sure you go deal with it the correct way. That's what our responsibility is. Oh, it's painful, isn't it? I mean, I just can't ignore it. I actually have to do something to help them along so that we're not sitting against one another, so that we're growing and redeeming, being completely restorative. Yes. Now we're done with step one. Now I've talked to the person. They've blown me off. Now step two. Take one or two other people with you. I want you to think about this. When I go to take the one or two other people with me, now I'm going to go to Ed and tell Ed about my problem. Ed, I talked to Jim, but he didn't give me any satisfaction. Let me tell you exactly what he did. No. Still, again, no. You talked to Jim. Yes, I talked to Jim, and I still didn't get any satisfaction, and there's still a conflict. Let me tell you about, I don't want to know the story. I don't want to know what the conflict is. Do you need my help to restore this conflict, to solve this conflict? Yes, I need a second person. Please come with me. It's like going between a mediator in a court of law. Literally, let's think about a court of law. When I go to a mediator, do I go to the mediator and present my case to them without the other person there? I don't, right? So I need you to be a judge between us, right? I just need you, because we haven't solved this yet. Then you go to the person. Then you get to tell your side of the story, and then the other person, guess what, gets to tell their side of the story. Why? I don't want to form an opinion of what has happened before the accused is in front of me. I don't. And sometimes we have to be bold when somebody wants us to come with them, or when somebody else has a problem with somebody else and they're telling us about it. We as believers have to be bold. Stop. Don't tell me. Well, I've already talked to them, right? We warned them. I've already talked to them. I need you to come with me. Okay, I'll come with you. But don't tell me the story yet. There's still a part that second person has to play. Unfortunately, if you're in that conflict and you bring that second person with you, what if you tell your side of the story, the person you have the conflict with tells their side of the story, and that second person looks at you and says, wait a minute, you are wrong. What they're saying to you is the right thing to do. That's that perspective that you thought. This person might have said it to you out of pure love because they want to help you grow and they see a fault in you. When I tell you about a fault, it's going to hurt you. It might bring some pain. You might despise me for it. Or you might get mad at me for it. And the conflict starts. Again, who's right, who's wrong? I'm trying to tell you out of love. Maybe I said it to you incorrectly. Maybe I said it to you in a mean way and I should have said it differently. Maybe there's... But see, the thing is sometimes we have to be willing to look at the conflict as I might be that wrong person. We may have to change our minds. However, there's also the case where that person is wrong, that they have sinned against you. Then there's step three. Step three is when you bring it to the church. Step three is when you bring the conflict to me. As the lead pastor, I am step three. I don't want to be step two. Find a leader in the church. We have leaders in the church. We have people that you respect spiritually. That's step two. That's the person you're bringing with you. Maybe it's not even your best friend. Hopefully it's not your best friend. Hopefully it's somebody you just respect spiritually. So they can mediate the issue. If the issue is no longer mediated, then you bring it to the church. And again, you bring an issue to me, and we have a conflict we have to deal with, don't tell me what it is. Chances are I already know the conflict exists. Because people talk, even though they shouldn't. Triangulation goes on in church, even though it shouldn't. But if you have to bring a conflict to me, you bring it to me. And again, we're going to sit down, we're going to talk about it. And you bring your witnesses with you. That second, third person. So now we're getting more of a committee of trying to solve the conflict. The idea is that we redeem it. The idea is that, as Stephen Covey says, it's a win-win situation. We both want to win. We both want to come out of this better. We both want to come out of this with growth. Is that possible to do in conflict? Absolutely. That's as a church, as believers, as a community of believers, as in this is our church. Do you believe that this is your church?
Yes.
Do you want your church to thrive?
Yes.
Then deal with the conflict right away. Right away. Immediately. And there will be times where we will get to step four. I would rather never get to step four. You know, as I told you last week, Bob and I parted ways. Well, he was a leader in the church, and our ideologies were so far different that we can't lead, we can't coexist and lead in the same place. That happens. Do I have any ill will towards Bob? No. As leaders, we can't lead together. No. And we talked about Paul and Barnabas. They separate. Because sometimes that happens. Unfortunately, sometimes that is the way things go. But don't let it fester. Right? Don't let it grow. Don't let the conflict that somebody gives you turn into something that is huge. Passive person. Catherine's like, oh no. But Catherine will get a splinter. That's all right. She'll get a second one, a third one, a fourth one, a fifth one, a sixth one. You know, and eventually all these little conflicts, they get to the point where they just beat you up because you haven't dealt with them. Yeah, she's going, yep.
I stuff it.
Yep, she stuffs it. Yep. And I evade and I evade and I evade. Eventually my wife says, Dan, you need to deal with this now.
My sister does it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't like dealing with a defensive person in a conflict. because they're defensive and they're aggressive at the same time. Right? No matter what, they're going to prove their point. They're going to prove that they're the right brain people. That I am always right. I have a special anointing from God. You can tell me whatever you want. But God talks to me only. You laugh, but unfortunately, I think I know people like that. And the aggressive person, you know you're going to go into a fight. You know, I'm going to walk in, I'm going to talk to this person, I'm going to talk face to face, and it's going to be a fight. And I almost know before I even start to talk that I'm not getting any satisfaction. I almost know by the time we're done, I'm going to be more ticked off than I was when I walked in. So when we get ready, when we go, okay, this person hurt me, I want to go talk to them. Even if it's just between you and the other person, there's a third person that we should bring into every conflict. Yeah, Jesus. Right? Because this is his church. And he's the Lord over the church. So I go to Jim. Jim, I want to talk to you. You said something that hurt me the other day. And before I go to Jim, I might pray. Right? Now, if you're the third person or the second person into a story, and now you're acting as a mediator. As a mediator, before we start to talk, let's bring in the Lord. Let's pray first. Let's pray that we will resolve it. Let's pray that we all walk out of here stronger for it. Jesus didn't tell us that the church would be fractured. He told us that the church would be whole, that the church would be complete, that the church would be strong. Deal with it right now, immediately, if not sooner. Now I want you to think. Let's take a couple moments. Let's think, let's ponder. Maybe you don't have a conflict at the moment. And that's great. Do you have a conflict? Do you have a conflict within the church body? Have you dealt with that conflict? Are you going to deal with that conflict? That's what I want you to get out of this service today. I want you to think, do I have a conflict? Have I dealt with that conflict? If not, deal with it. Not to hurt the other person, but to heal yourself. So we can be fully, completely restored. So we can live out the abundant life that Christ gave us. That's what he wants us to do. I can't fully experience God's love, joy, and peace when I let conflict fester. Can't do it. And he wants us to be full of love, full of joy, full of peace. He wants us to walk in it. And he tells us how to do so. Gives us guidelines to get there. I want to be a church that loves one another completely. I want to be a church that doesn't let the infection fester. I think we can get there. I think we can be awesome. Pray with me every day that God will build this body into a body of believers that he wants. Fully restored, fully redeemed, and loving him and one another, unconditional. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your mercy. And Lord, Holy Spirit, as we read the words that you spoke on how to deal with conflict, Holy Spirit, that you would give us the ability to listen to your word, not just listen to it, but to obey it, to act on it. Because you tell us these things. Lord, so that we can be whole, so that we can be complete, so that we can have an abundant life. And Lord, help us to step into that. Help us to live out your word, to be people that you want us to be the people you created us to be. Lord, I pray for those that will be the second and third person into a conflict. Holy Spirit, that you give those leaders, you give those mediators the wisdom to speak truth into the conflict. Again, Lord, so we can restore, so we can be complete. Holy Spirit, I ask that as we go out today, that we just love you, that we just stand before you. Give you thanks for all you've done, for all you're doing, for all you're going to do. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Now those online, have an awesome, fantastic week. And remember, if you have conflict, if we have conflict, deal with it today. See you, everybody. Yeah.